Be real with a spaz of realness here on KWDC 93.5 FM, the voice of Stockton. I'm not concerned with your liking or disliking me. All I ask is that you respect me as a human being. Jackie Robinson. Tolerance and respect. One of these two, the ability or willingness to tolerate something, in particular with the instance of opinions or behaviors that one does not necessarily agree with. When respect is a feeling of deep admiration for someone or something by their abilities, qualities, or achievements. Respect for ourselves guides our morals. Respect for others guides our manners. A person's a person, no matter how small. Dr. Seuss, who teaches our kids, who taught us in childhood to just respect each other. There is no respect for others without humility in oneself. We don't need to share the same opinions as others, but we need to be respectful. Respect your efforts. Respect yourself. Self-respect leads to self-discipline. When you have both firmly under your belt, that's real power. Because in the practice of tolerance, one's enemy is the best teacher. Dalai Lama. Islam teaches tolerance, not hatred, universal brotherhood, and not animosity, peace, and not violence. Tolerance implies no lack of commitment to one's own beliefs. Rather, it condemns the oppression or percussion of others, pre-suction of others. What is tolerance? It is the consequence of humanity. We are all formed of frailty and error. Let us pardon reciprocally each other's folly. That is the first law of nature. Tolerance, compromise, understanding, acceptance, patience. I want those all to be very sharp tools in my shed. Tolerance is you saying something crazy and me smiling and saying, that's nice. Acceptance and tolerance and forgiveness, those are life-altering lessons. It is essential to employ trust and reward those whose perspective, ability, and judgment are radically different from yours. It is also rare, for it requires uncommon humanity. It is also rare, for it requires uncommon humility, tolerance, and wisdom. I believe all Americans who believe in freedom, tolerance, and human rights have a responsibility to oppose bigotry and prejudice based on sexual orientation. Coretta Scott King. I learned that very often the most intolerant and narrow-minded people are those who congratulate themselves on their tolerance and open-mindedness. The test of courage comes when we are the minority. The test of tolerance comes when we are the majority. The highest result of education is tolerance. I firmly believe that respect is a lot more important and a lot greater than popularity. Respect yourself if you would have others respect you. To be one, to be united, is a great thing, but to respect the right to be different is maybe even greater. I think I'm naturally born a leader. I know how to bow down to authority. If it's authority, that I respect. Tupac Shakur. The final test of a gentleman is respect for those who can be of no possible service to him. Respect is what we owe. Love is what we give. And this has been your Spaz of Realness. Here on KWDC 93.5 FM. The voice of Stockton.
You're listening to KWDC LP Stockton.
Alrighty then.
How could I have been so careless? 1.21 gigawatts.
I don't even know what that means.
No one knows what it means, but it's provocative.
No, it's nice.
You blew it!
What?
is your name?
Movie releases, DVD rentals, and more here on The Movie Talk on KWDC 93.5 FM.
You're listening to KWDC LP Stockton, and this is The Movie Talk Show. I'm your host, Sertaj Bangu, and in the booth with me today is Paul Bestos.
What's up?
And Alton Henry.
Stockton.
Wednesdays is the Great Director segment, and the Great Director for this month is Martin Scorsese. I'm sure you've heard of him. Today we're going to be discussing Taxi Driver and Wolf of Wall Street, one of his earliest films and his last film. So, guys, let's jump right into it with Taxi Driver. Paul, I understand you have a log line for us?
Yes.
All right.
The plot of the film follows the vigilante taxi driver Travis Bickle in the 80s New York. Dealing with insomnia, Travis becomes obsessed with helping a young prostitute return to her parents' home.
Okay. And this is a pretty psychological film, I'd say. It is considered one of the greatest films the world has ever seen.
I agree.
You agree? Alton, would you agree?
Yes. I would say that.
So, first question for you guys. Why do you think this is one of the most important pieces of cinema for all generations?
For, is it America, or is it for the whole world to see?
I'd say it's a important piece of cinema for the whole world, yeah, for history.
Well,
do you agree with that?
Well, I mean, I would agree that there are certain aspects of the film is worth of seeing for a lot of cinema goers, because the film tackles a lot of interesting themes, and yeah, it is a psychological drama about a Vietnam veteran who comes back and tries to readjust his life in New York City, and he becomes disgusted from what he's seen, as a veteran, and what he sees as getting a job as a taxi driver. He doesn't like the negativity, or just the dark side of humanity, because he's seen too much of it.
He's kind of disgusted with the world.
He's kind of disgusted with the world, and he believes by saving this prostitute, which at first she wanted to, but then I guess she starts to deny it later on in the film. And isn't this Jodie Foster's first film?
I'm not sure if it is her first role.
So she kind of tries to deny it, but I really think that the film really captures Travis Bickle, who plays by Robert De Niro. I really think that the film really captures his disgust of how dark the humanity is, and Martin Scorsese really did a good job on it. And plus the director himself also has a cameo in the film.
Yeah.
I mean, just to play off that, like you were saying, the movie comes off as following a lonely character with mental illness. If you haven't seen the movie, you might remember the famous line, "You talking to me?" And Roger Ebert says, and I kind of agree with this, that the line is usually misquoted when Travis finishes the line finishes with, "I'm the only one here." And that really paves the path for the true essence of the film. He's the only one there, and he's dealing with this loneliness. A lot of people don't really understand the movie, because they see Travis as a rational person, because he's doing a violent act for the sake of saving someone he doesn't even know. You know what I mean?
Well, Travis, the character, gets, you see a mental break within the movie with this character, and he becomes a taxi driver because of insomnia. Mm-hmm. And so he's lonely and depressed, and then he starts going out, and then as a taxi driver, seeing all this, the crime, the dark side of New York City, and he is kind of sick of the world. And then also when he tries to form a relationship with a woman who works at a campaign, she volunteers at a campaign office for a senator who's a presidential candidate. So he gets involved with her, and she basically rejects him. He becomes more and more lonely, and that is when he kind of snaps. He becomes a little bit more violent, and that's when he gets this whole conditioning, and he buys the guns, and he gets into a violent mindset. So
talking about it makes me want to go buy the movie right now.
The movie's really, really good. Mm-hmm.
There's one scene. Oh, actually, like I would like your interpretation on this. There's a scene like close to the end of the film where he goes to the campaign and he shaved his head and looks like he was about to pull his gun out and looks like he might kill the senator. Yeah, the senator. But the guards see that and then he takes out. What is your interpretation on that? Like, do you think he was conflicted on
why doesn't he shoot him?
Yeah, like why doesn't he?
Yeah,
I think it's because the Secret Service saw him. Like he was gonna do it. And actually, he wrote a letter to Iris, the prostitute played by Jodie Foster. He writes in his letter that he's gonna die today, and he leaves her a bunch of money so she can like go home. But I think he doesn't go through with it because he gets kind of scared of the Secret Service. He doesn't actually want to die right then and there. That's what I think.
I feel like he kind of feels for Iris, and he wants to help her get away from like the prostitution.
Right.
And he feels like that trying to get rid of a candidate. Wouldn't help that condition, so that's why in the end he goes and kills all the pimps and the gangsters just to save her.
Exactly, and I think he
just to add meaning to his life.
Okay, yeah.
Exactly. That's a great point. He wants to add meaning to his life.
Yeah,
because he's alone and empty, and then he kind of vents it through this violence, and he creates some meaning in his life.
But he's always wanting to be the hero too. There's a lot of shots. When he's in the taxi and he's always looking in his rearview mirror, but then the perspective we see is his eyes.
Right.
And then later on in the film, he's talking to himself in the mirror, and he's kind of having like almost like an identity crisis. And yeah, right there, it kind of paves the way of.
Right. And I like how you mentioned that, because the very last shot is him looking. If I remember correctly, it's the last shot is him looking at the woman that worked at the campaign center, and basically he's kind of lets her go.
Right.
And he's looking at the mirrors, the rearview mirror. And
he sees himself as a hero throughout this movie, and that's his reflection. That's what he wants to be. And in the end of the movie, he kind of gets that in a way. You see, it almost looks like a dream because we're seeing in the newspapers that he's famous and the media has made him famous. And this is like a one thing that I think that movies don't talk about often is the media does glorify like
mass killers. We should kind of expand on that for people who haven't seen the movie. So basically, he commits like a triple homicide, right? He kills the pimp, he kills a customer, and then like a bouncer type guy.
Right. Yeah.
To basically save Iris, but. Really, we know his motivations, and his motivations is to be a hero, right? It's kind of selfish. He's kind of in a weird mindset, and then he's basically he wants to kill himself at the end too. He's gonna shoot himself, but he's out of ammo, and then he goes to prison, and then he finds out later that he's heralded as a hero, and the media puts him in this a really nice. Light.
Well, that's why I don't think it's a dream sequence, and a lot of people get confused when they see it. Like, oh, is he always dreaming of this? And it's like, no, it's not it at all. It's it boils down to him wanting that fame and him getting it from his crime.
So you really think he actually got that fame?
Yeah, I think what he wanted to happen, it kind of did happen in a sense. And I the screenwriter, I have it written down here. His name is, let me see, his first name, I think his last name is Schrader.
Mm-hmm.
He writes his inspiration for the screenplay is from Dostoevsky's Notes from the Underground, and I feel like it's kind of like Crime and Punishment, too. He steals from that story a little bit, and so we're following a lonely character who thinks the world is corrupt and bad, and he wants to help, but he thinks he has to, you know, kill people to get the bad people out of the way so he can help. So save, kill a few, save a thousand, I guess is the term. And the screenwriter does say he's supposed to be paranoid with the psychosis from the war. There's another thing he says that was very important. If I can find it.
Well, we'll let you find that. We have to take a very, very short break. Kind of saved you there.
Yeah, I did.
And we'll be right back. Please stay tuned.
sack. Is that all you get for your money? And it seems such a waste of time. If that's what it's all about, Mama, if that's moving up, then I'm moving out. Moving out. I'm moving out.
Eating habits developed in childhood can last a lifetime, but getting children to eat their fruits and vegetables is a common problem. Eating them adds important nutrients, helps control weight, and reduces the risks for many serious illnesses. Children in the U.S. are eating more fruit, however, 60% of children get fewer fruits than recommended, and 93% don't get enough vegetables. Childcare, schools, and school districts can help change this, by meeting or exceeding federal nutrition standards for meals and snacks, including fruits and vegetables wherever food is offered, and helping children learn about and taste fruits and vegetables. At home, parents can eat a variety of fruits and vegetables with their children and provide them as snacks, even if it takes many tries. Also, parents can include their children when shopping for, growing, and preparing fruits and vegetables. To learn more, visit cdc.gov/vital signs.
You're listening to KWDC LP Stockton.
Alrighty then.
How could I have been so careless? 1.21 gigawatts!
I don't even know what that means.
No one knows what it means, but it's provocative.
No, it's nice.
Blew it!
What is your name?
Movie releases, DVD rentals, and more here on The Movie Talk on KWDC 93.5 FM.
And we're back. You're listening to The Movie Talk Show right here on KWDC. We were just talking about the great piece of movie history, Taxi Driver. Right before we cut to break, Paul, you're going to tell us a little bit more about the screenwriter?
Yes,
yeah.
I was. I finally found what I was looking for.
Yeah, what was his name?
His last name is Schrader.
Schrader? Okay.
Yeah, I don't really know his first name.
But
anyway, he says in a comment, I guess... some people online were asking questions about the film, and he like responded to someone.
Oh, his first name is Paul Schrader, or it's Paul.
Oh, yeah. Well, I don't remember that. I remember that. So he says he responded to this person about the end of the movie, and he said the movie simply returns to the beginning of the film, and it's not a dream sequence. So even the writer says it's not a dream sequence. But he says there's a lot of coincidences, and these coincidences appear throughout the film. And Scorsese even acknowledged several critics' interpretation of the ending. And he admits that the last scene is Bickle glancing at the unseen object. That implies that Bickle might fall into a rage and recklessness in the future. And he's like a ticking time bomb,
right?
Basically.
Okay.
And so the analysis based off the screenwriter and, you know, Scorsese's interpretation is Bickle is a Vietnam vet, and through the trauma, he has the psychosis. And he's also driving as a taxi driver in this really torn down, you know, society. But if you look at the beginning of the film in the credit sequence, mm-hmm. He's all the places he drives by are where he goes throughout the whole film. So it's interesting to see him going to the same exact places, like, and just by going to these places, he's fueling his hate even more.
So it kind of feels like to
it's
me,
it's like he's purposely going back.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right.
It's
really or I kind of see that he's stuck in that world and he just can't get out, and it's driving him insane to stay in that
that's
world.
That's a good way to, yeah.
And then when he looked at the mirror at the end, maybe it's just a reflection of him being, even though it's interpreted as him being a hero, maybe he is a hero. It's just he's a hero that's stuck in that world, and he might have to continue to do his vigilante acts, and which might lead him to insanity. Oh, if he keeps doing that.
Yeah, I don't think he's a hero, though. I mean, do you guys think he's a hero in the end?
No, but the media is making him like one.
Exactly.
No. Me neither.
Okay. All right. Okay, so next question for you guys. What is your favorite scene in the movie?
Oh, man.
Yeah.
For me, I remember when I first saw this movie, I really enjoyed it because it was really the first time it depicted loneliness, and we're just following a character. And what I like about Scorsese the most is he follows characters and what they do rather than having just a story unfolds. Most of the time when you're seeing a Hollywood movie, you're seeing a character being forced into a fantasy world, and then they have to deal with that, or they have some kind of goal they have to achieve or some object they have to get. And in Scorsese's, he kind of makes the characters flow with their own ideas, and their actions dictate, you know, their inner desires. And that reveals, like, the true essence of society. And I think Scorsese thinks the society is corrupt. And my favorite scene that really hits home for this, what you're asking, is the shootout.
Mm-hmm.
But there's one specific part. The movie kind of does, like, Travis like shoots his gun at someone for the first time, and it cuts to a bunch of hallways as the gunshot echoes as if everyone's hearing it.
Right.
And then it kind of goes to like a slow-mo scene, and the audio track is kept the same. So, you know, when you see action scenes and someone gets shot and they're like, and it's like in slow-mo.
Yeah.
But he keeps the audio and he keeps the dialogue in the shot. And I thought that was like one of the most amazing pieces of editing I've seen in that little short segment of that action sequence.
Yeah.
And I even for this film I'm doing now, I like sent a link to everyone in the crew, and I was like, this is kind of what I'm going for the action sequence, where it's a different kind of way to approach an action movie. Instead of just using slow-mo on impacts, he's using slow-mo when like a character's walking or reacting to something.
Yeah, very interesting point.
That's my favorite scene is the shootout segment. Because it's so artistically done in that respect.
Wow. Alton, what about you?
The same thing.
Same thing?
Yeah, and there was another scene I really liked that. I really liked the scene where he meets the guy that gives him the guns, the weapons.
Then
he tests them out, and then the shot that I really like is where he points the gun at a car and he follows the car with that gun.
I thought
that scene was very, very tense. Like, okay, what is, like, it kind of makes you think, like, what's he thinking about, but you don't really know for sure.
He's thinking about killing some people.
Yeah. I mean, obviously, but then it's like, okay, how is he going to approach it?
You really get, like, in subtle ways, you see that this character is mentally, imbalanced.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm kind of a bummer right now because that's the shootout scene is my favorite scene too. It's really, really well done. It's crazy. I watched it on YouTube. It's awesome.
Yeah.
And then another one would be like the famous, you know, you talking to me scene. Another one is where he keeps he's kind of following the female character that works at the campaign and kind of like watching her, but he never like introduces himself, and it's only when like another guy starts like talking to her that he like jumps out of the car and then goes into the campaign office, you know what I mean? So he's basically like in the beginning he's kind of stalking her,
right?
And the way that he shows him just like just watching her is, I don't know, it adds to like
the character.
Exactly. Adds the creepiness.
Yeah
cool. I know. All right, so let's move on to our analysis of the movie. Paul, I know you got a lengthy one for us this time.
Well, actually, I kind of broke it down throughout the whole thing, so it might not be too lengthy.
Okay.
It's actually going to be pretty short because I kind of discussed the same things. Like I said before, a lot of people don't like this movie because of the violence, and it's known for almost being rated.
Rated X.
Rated X because of its violence.
Which they don't do that anymore.
Right.
Yeah. But the character's life, his goals are very senseless, and after the shootout scene, the glorification of violence through the media, newspaper clippings we see on Travis's wall, kind of comes to light, and I feel like Scorsese always wants to tell the story of how society is corrupt. In all his movies, he's kind of wanting to say that message, how we're making criminals look good, and we totally are, in a way.
Yeah.
And through media, this is what comes down. It comes down for me. I don't want to be too political or anything, but let me see here. Actually, I want to know what you guys think first.
Okay.
Before I get into, like, what do you think? Do you think?
Satosh.
All right, I'll go first.
Like
I think
the mass shootings and stuff with that movie compared to the media.
Oh, okay. Well, Scorsese definitely wants to show that the media does glorify violence and sort of misinformation, almost, you could say, because they don't really get the full story with Travis, right? The guy's pretty almost insane. I mean, he's insane. He was almost assassinated a presidential candidate, but before that, he, you know, took out some pimps and stuff. So, and then they glorify that. I think Scorsese throughout the movie is trying to show that we live in a dark world filled with dark people, and Travis is disgusted by what he sees, but us as viewers are almost disgusted at him.
It's kind of like a reflection a little bit.
Exactly.
Some people they're disgusted on just how violent the world is, but we also, I mean, just like TV, we watch a lot of violent movies.
Mm-hmm.
Even some of the cartoons, they're violent. Like if you go back to Tom and Jerry, even though that doesn't have any blood, it's kind of a violent cartoon to show for kids. So we glorify that. It's entertaining. Yet if you watch Taxi Driver, you get disgusted by him because he hates it. How humanity is able to accept their cruelty. And yet we glorify that at the same time. I thought that was really interesting. Look at it when you watch Taxi Driver, and when you actually think about it, we do glorify violence. I mean, if you go to war and all that, we glorify that. We promote it. So I mean, I think that movie does a good job to really show that fact.
And even like news coverage, I feel like
definitely.
When there's like a mass shooting, they do over-discuss, I guess, the situation, but they want to get into the killer's past and why he did it. And that kind of, in my opinion, that doesn't really matter. What matters is the victims that were a part of it. We should get their story. And the news, for about 2 weeks, 24/7, they'll just stick on that same story. Why did this guy do this? What's going to happen to him? And they'll get other people's opinions from other news sources. And you know what they blame? They blame violent movies and video games.
Yeah, and they also
they don't blame the news, they don't blame themselves, but they're like, definitely he was cited to be playing video games and they had a gun in it. Or he was cited to watch a violent movie and now he might have been inspired by that violent movie, you know? They make it up as they go on.
All right, well, that was our discussion of Taxi Driver. We're going to take a short break, and then we're going to get into The Wolf of Wall Street. We'll be right back.
Let's do it.
You know, sometimes we're not prepared for adversity. When it happens, sometimes we're caught short. We don't know exactly how to handle it when it comes up. Sometimes we don't know just what to do when adversity takes over. And I have advice for all of us. I got it from our pianist, Joe Zawinul, who wrote this tune. And it sounds like what you're supposed to say when you have that kind of problem. It's called Mercy. 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 mercy, 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 mercy. Thank you.
Lots of experts talk about the ways that schools should inspire students to be creative. How you doing? I'm John Prime. They say that helping young minds tap their creativity is just as important as mastering math or their English skills. And of course, all parents love to experience the joy of seeing and hearing something their child has created. Well, one of the best places creativity is actively encouraged is in music class. There you'll find kids working out a phrase in a choir part, learning technical stuff such as fingerings on an instrument, or even composing and arranging music on computers. Music classrooms are bursting with creative energy just waiting to be explored by young minds. So don't let it go to waste. Support your school music program. Thank you.
A PSA brought to you by MENC, the National Association for Music Education, and the National Anthem Project, the campaign to restore America's voice through music education. Music, part of a sound education.
You're listening to KWDC LP Stockton.
Alrighty then.
How could I have been so careless? 1.21 gigawatts!
I don't even know what that means.
No one knows what it means, but it's provocative.
No, it's nice.
You blew it!
What? Is your name?
Movie releases, DVD rentals, and more here on The Movie Talk on KWDC 93.5 FM.
And we're back. We were just talking about Taxi Driver, and we're moving on to The Wolf of Wall Street.
Wolf, Wolf.
Yes. So, The Wolf of Wall Street, it's a fairly recent movie. It came out in 2013, and it's kind of a black comedy satire kind of thing. And it stars Leonardo DiCaprio and Jonah Hill.
With Matthew McConaughey.
And Matthew McConaughey. It makes an awesome appearance. I love his role in that movie. So, The Wolf of Wall Street is about a real-life person named Jordan Belfort. And basically, it's a story of corruption. He's a banker in Wall Street, and he basically steals a bunch of money.
And funds his own company.
Yeah, funds his own company.
And does the same thing.
Yeah. Do you guys remember the company name? It was Stratton something?
I think it was Stratton. Yeah.
Stratton Oakmont. Right. Yeah. So, first of all, did you guys like this movie? What did you like about it?
I really enjoyed the movie. It's one of my favorite Martin Scorsese movies. And I really liked it that it didn't hold back on its content. Like it really went hardcore. When I watched it, I had little expectations for it, but then when I watched it, it really grew my expectations like unexpectedly, and I loved it. I love every single minute of it, despite being 3 hours long.
Yeah, it's a long movie
for well, a comedy.
Yeah,
For me, I saw it like opening day, and out of all of his movies, this one for me at least was the least entertaining, just because of its content and the runtime. The same scenes and events are unfolding one after another for the first 2 hours. You know, sex, violence, back and forth, until like the third act where there's consequence, some kind of consequences that are revealed. But the highlight of the movie is also the media is kind of glorifying the crimes and stuff, and the because in the end the main character is now popular for the crimes because he works for the police
right.
in cases of deception. It's not a bad movie, and I do like how it's made, and I like how Scorsese uses similar storytelling techniques and themes. But I only saw this movie once, so I can't really give it a critique or review.
Okay.
I always, my rule of thumb and rule for myself is, if I don't like a movie, I need to see it again or a couple more times to truly appreciate it. That's just saying some of my favorite movies are movies I've hated the first viewing. So I do need to see it again. And I need to appreciate it, of course.
Right.
And my views will probably change.
Okay.
In the second viewing. Or
whatever. Well, I really enjoyed the movie. I thought it was well done. And it was long, but it was entertaining throughout.
Actually, it didn't seem that long to me.
Yeah, it didn't seem that long because... It's just so much
really,
is happening.
Yeah, yeah. Just so much is happening. It really sucks you in. It doesn't seem like a three-hour movie.
Yeah, and it's kind of a controversial film. It has a lot of morally ambiguous depiction of events, a lot of sexual content.
But it's truthful, which I did like about it.
Yeah. I mean, I could see that stuff really happening. Yeah.
And last Wednesday, I remember I told you guys that story about when I watched it in theaters.
Watched it with your brother?
Yeah, I watched it with my brother. And we went in, and there was an elderly couple in there. And I think they wanted to watch like a wholesome Leonardo DiCaprio movie. And then they had to walk out because the first scene is,
Well, at least you watched it with your brother, dude. And I watched it with my mom.
Oh, man.
You watched it with your mom, right?
Yeah, I watched it with my mom.
Bad call. It's a Scorsese movie, man. Like, you had to have known.
I don't think I would take my mom to see one of these movies.
If I knew of it, like, that content that much, then I wouldn't have, like,
Did she like the movie?
No.
She might have liked it. I don't know.
I mean, she thought it was decent, but she didn't like all that nudity that was going on, and the drugs and stuff.
Yeah. Well, this movie is a critical and commercial success. It had 5 nominations at the Academy Awards for Best Picture, Best Director for Scorsese, Best Writing for Adapted Screenplay, Best Actor, and Supporting Actor.
I was disappointed that DiCaprio did not win. I was surprised.
Every time he's nominated, man.
I thought he should have won this one.
I feel like I thought this was his best role, too.
Yeah.
As much as I didn't that much like the movie, I did like him as in the role.
I mean, I thought I didn't like J. Edgar, but I feel like he should have won for that. I mean, his performance on that was pretty great.
That movie didn't really catch me.
Yeah, that movie was. It was all right. Well, anyway.
But he should have won.
Yeah, he should have won.
What other movies were playing that year? Do you know?
Wait, 2013, Prisoners.
Prisoners?
Oh, that one was really good.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Well, yeah. Shame. So there's a lot of things that I like about the movie, and I love the way that they handle. Scorsese doesn't do really voiceover for this movie too much. He does, but in the beginning, I love it when Leonardo DiCaprio is talking directly to the camera, to us, the viewer. He's telling us the story, basically. Yeah. And he does that throughout. And basically, as events unfold, they get crazier and crazier. And he's basically telling you this story, which I really like. What is your guys' favorite scenes from the movie? There's some good ones.
There's some good ones. It's hard to really. I would have to say the scene that really stand out for me, which I thought was one of the funniest, where Matthew McConaughey came in.
Oh yeah,
yeah. The dinner table scene. He's just telling. Basically, that scene was to actually set off Leonardo DiCaprio's character.
Right.
Yeah. It kind of foreshadows what his character is going to do.
Going to become.
Or what he's going to become in the movie. Right. And I kind of like that scene because I thought it was really good. And I thought it was actually a really funny scene. It's probably one of my favorite Matthew McConaughey movies, even though he's only in there for like 10 minutes.
It's all improv too, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
It felt like a real, all that movie was, it seemed real, the dialogue and everything.
Yeah, the dialogue was very realistic.
I really liked the scene where, which I thought it was really funny. I don't think a lot of people thought it was funny. It was the last scene you saw Matthew McConaughey in, and then it's where I guess all the stocks end up crashing down, and then everybody lost their job, and Matthew McConaughey looks at it, he's like, holy.
Yeah.
And he's like, he's in shock, and DiCaprio has that sad face, like, really? This is, like, I wasn't even at this job for that long, and I lose it. Like, you kidding me? He has to go find another job.
Yeah.
I thought that scene was funny. Then John Bruthel, he's in the movie. He's known for playing Shane in The Walking Dead. He was funny.
His character was good.
Yeah, I kind of wanted him to be in the movie a little longer because he was hilarious.
Yeah. Paul, what were your favorite scenes?
For me, the one scene that stands out I thought was this hilarious. Where I don't really laugh when I see a movie out loud in a theater, but I felt like there's this scene that really did make me laugh. It was, I think DiCaprio was on like drugs and he's like trying to walk to his car down the stairs.
Yeah.
And it's just how it happens is really funny and comedic.
Oh, yeah.
And it looks real. That whole scene where his wife's involved, everyone's involved, Jonah Hill's involved.
Oh, yeah. With the way he's talking on the phone.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's one of my favorites.
My favorite scene. That one's up there, definitely, where he loses all control of his motor functions. Oh, man. Another scene that I really liked was where he's basically he's talking to the camera, and it's like a really long shot where he's walking through the offices of Stride and Oakmont, and he says something like he's explaining what like penny stocks is probably or something like that, and then he's like, well, that doesn't matter. The real question is, was this legal, right? And
yeah, then, absolutely.
And he's like, no. Yeah. And so that scene is awesome. Another one would probably be, oh man.
Was it the, I was thinking the ship scene.
The ship scene, yeah, that was a really good one. Yeah, that was where the whole thing, where he's in his yacht and when they get saved as well, was pretty funny. So a part of this is where he's trying to get to his like Swiss bank, I think. So he's trying to get back, and they pass through a storm in his yacht, and they basically just have to like abandon ship, and then his plane home gets like struck by lightning.
Yeah.
And oh man.
Okay. I thought that scene kind of represented like a foreshadow or something.
Yeah. Well, we'll talk a little bit more about Wolf of Wall Street right after this short break.
Goldfinger, he's the man with the Midas touch, a spider's touch, such a cold finger. From Mr. Goldfinger. Pretty girl, beware of his heart of gold. This heart is cold. Golden words he will pour in your ear, but his lies can't disguise what you fear. For a golden girl knows when he kisses her. It's the kiss of death from Mr. Goldfinger. Pretty girl, beware of his heart of gold. This heart is cold. He loves only gold, only gold. He loves only gold. He loves only gold, only gold. He loves gold.
You're listening to KWDC LP Stockton.
Alrighty then.
How could I have been so careless? 1.21 gigawatts!
I don't even know what that means.
No one knows what it means, but it's provocative.
No, it's nice.
You blew it!
What is your name?
Movie releases, DVD rentals, and more here on The Movie Talk on KWDC 93.5 FM.
And we're back. All right, we were just talking about The Wolf of Wall Street. Awesome movie. Pretty crazy Scorsese movie. So I want to hear your guys' analysis of the movie. Alton, you want to go first?
Well, what I really think about the film is that, one, it really does glorify corruption in the film. And then what really kind of got me puzzled was the ending, how the movie ended, where it kind of resolved everything, and where Jordan Belfort, played by Leonardo DiCaprio, is in jail, but he tells you that, I mean, he still has money in his pocket, so he's kind of living a little easy in prison. So, and there's this shot where you actually see the real Jordan Belfort, and then DiCaprio goes to this presentation as fictional Jordan Belfort, and he tests people about sell me this pen.
Yeah.
And then one guy couldn't do it, and then he goes to the next person to see if he could sell them that pen. And then the camera pins away from DiCaprio and towards the rest of the crowd. And I kind of think that moment where we we are kind of really aggressive consumers, so we'll let anybody try to persuade us to actually do something that we kind of don't want to do. Because that kind of, I mean, that scene was actually, there's a similar scene that happens earlier in the movie where Jordan Belfort starts to begin his company.
Right.
And I really felt like, that we're all suckers. Like we're all suckers, yeah. To
as long as there's a promise of money involved.
Yeah, as long as you don't know whether it's real or fake, whether you're being persuaded to get something. Mm-hmm. At the end that you're kind of gonna lose at that part. I might have gotten that interpretation misinformed, but right. That's what I think about it. What do you guys think on that, Andy?
So my analysis, I kind of think a lot of people think that The Wolf of Wall Street is a critique on Wall Street and about the corruption and greed and whatnot, but I think it's really a critique of the viewer, of you. I think it's they show Jordan Belfort, this guy who has everything, who's doing some bad things, but they never really show the consequences. Sure, like he leaves his wife and there's a divorce and whatnot, but that, I mean, he's still ends up on top, money, and he's still like, you know, being with all like supermodels or whatever, and they never show, you know, the people who lost their jobs. They never show the people that his actions directly affected. And throughout the movie, I feel like everyone sort of wants to be Jordan Belfort. I think everyone wants to emulate this lifestyle where I can have anything or do anything. I can party as much as I want. Sure, I'm doing bad stuff, but whatever, right? So I think Scorsese is really trying to show us that Wall Street is just, Wall Street isn't the problem, we're the problem. I think that he's really pointing at greed and saying that this is what's wrong with the world. Instead of like Wall Street's just a symptom.
Yeah, because we're always looking up into the we're looking up at the wrong role models.
Right.
Yeah.
And then how you're saying like the last shot where it pans into the audience of
observing.
They're looking at Jordan Belfort. They're looking at him in awe, in like respect. They're hanging on to everything he says, and they really want to know how can I sell someone this pen, because they want to know how they can make money. That's about it. I think that's what
in a way that kind of that will deceive others and hurt others in order to get that fame. Yeah.
Yeah. So basically, Scorsese is saying we'll look out or we'll overlook the outrageous behavior as long as we get a chance to make some big money. Paul, what about you?
Yeah, I agree with both of you. Yeah. Just to add on, I feel like this movie has similarities with Taxi Driver. The biggest contrast, though, is in Taxi Driver, Travis Bickle is very poor, and he's at his job most of the movie. And in Wolf of Wall Street, the character is very rich. He kind of just does whatever he wants. And both lead a life of violence and crime to be what they want to be. And with that similarity, like you said, Scorsese has the same theme going with greed and corruption. But more in sense with this movie, it focuses on what money can do to people, and how role models can affect just the minds of
society as a whole.
And right. And in the end of the movie, he's... usually after criminals commit a crime, like a notorious criminal,
right,
the police kind of want them to do, you know, help out with the enforce laws and police work, basically, I guess I'd say. I don't know how to say it. And they become local celebrities for their acts in America's unbalanced society. And I feel in this movie, it kind of shows that.
Right.
So that is my small analysis.
Yeah, so again, Scorsese showing that how the media sort of glorifies people who shouldn't be glorified.
Yes.
Yeah.
All right. Okay.
All the above.
So do you think in the end, Jordan Belfort is a changed man?
No, of course not. I don't think he changes at all.
All right.
Which is another thing, like why people don't like this movie, is the character never changes. There's no character arcs. Because this is what a criminal's like.
Yeah.
They don't change. Yeah.
And it's really interesting to think that this is based on an autobiography. And I like to, I kind of wanted to say, throw this out there, that maybe Jordan Belfort's character is just telling a story, right? And he's exaggerating a lot of stuff because he's sucking in the audience that he wants to control, right? It's kind of a deception. And maybe...
That's his whole crime, is deception.
Yeah, there you go.
That's a good way to look at it.
Yeah, maybe he's just, you know, because he's the last person you want to trust, especially when he's telling the story.
Jordan
Belfort, because he's just going to lie to your face.
He's a bad guy.
Yeah, because in the movie, like, he does not falter on trying to persuade people of which will benefit him. Like, where he's training his friends of how to sell that pen, and then I keep forgetting the guy's last name. Anyway, he keeps persuading people to do the same thing he's doing so he can aim higher in success. So that's right.
Okay, well, that is about the end of our show. Big thanks to San Joaquin Delta College, to the Delta College Radio Television Department. They're awesome. Definitely check out the RTV department. Thanks to everyone at KWDC and also to Team Elevate Speed School. If you want to check it out, it's on Saturday, July 11th, 2015. You can train with some sprinters and be a better athlete. That's right here at San Joaquin Delta College. Thanks to everyone in the booth. Thank you, Paul. Thank you, Alton. And thank you, Eric, the board op. You're awesome. This has been Movie Talk.
No problem.
Say that again. I don't think they heard you.
No problem.
All right. Awesome. This has been Movie Talk Show. See you on Friday.
KWDC LP Stockton, 93.5 FM.
Blue is my favorite color. What's yours?